of clothes and footsteps, and there's an apparition that is seen in the engine room.
Well, this is gonna be a big ship, you know.
Sorry.
No place has stopped us yet. No place is gonna stop us now.
Love that attitude.
Good attitude, Steve.
Oh, jeez.
Holy mother of God.
This place is friggin' huge.
Oh man, look at this.
Thank you.
Hi.
How are you?
Hi, my name's Judith.
I'm
Jason Ship's historian.
Hi, Grant.
Steve, how are you?
You ready to take your tour?
Absolutely. I'm ready to hear some stories.
Okay, we're ready.
All right, show us to Lexington. Let's go.
I'm really grateful that TAPS has come to visit us. Almost 400 men have died aboard this ship. I don't like to think that they're not resting, but I guess that's what's happening, because they're still here.
Look at the size of this.
It's 910 feet long.
Jeez.
The ship was in 21 out of 24 battles during World War II. Okay, in 1992, a former crew member was on his duty station around midnight, and he was up there on pry fly.
Oh, wow.
Up there on the catwalk.
Okay.
And he noticed a round ball, like about the size of a beach ball. And it was glowing blue.
It was about 4 feet off the floor. There was a glow of bright blue, white light, and it had rays coming out from it. And then all of a sudden, it just got sucked into space, it was gone.
All right, I'd just like to tell you what happened over there where that Japanese flag is. Well, in 1943, there was two bogeys coming in. Our gunners shot the first plane down. The second plane, our guns were shooting straight at him, but he got closer and closer. He was carrying a 500-pound bomb. And the tip of his wing, his right wing, hit right where that flag is. The plane flipped over and slid. It exploded, and it killed 50 of our men and wounded 135.
Where are we heading now?
Down to the hangar deck so we can go in the forward passageway. One thing that happened here, a visitor was here, and he started to walk forward, and a man dressed in full Navy uniform, World War II uniform, came out of the door over there and started to walk through that doorway, and then he disappeared.
Was he see-through?
He could see through him. And that's just one of the several instances that's happened here. And I personally have had several instances happen to me. Nobody was aboard but me and this other employee, Jackie. And suddenly, right here, it was a voice, a man's voice said, "Hey!" And we stopped and looked at each other. And I said, "Jackie, did you hear anything?" And she said, "I heard somebody yell, 'Hey,' twice." Just as long as I wasn't the only one.
Jeez.
Yeah.
All right, so where to now?
One of the things that's happened is one of our employees started to come through the passageway here, and she saw a man walking like this, and he just walked right through the wall. Last thing she saw was his foot going through.
Has that always been a wall?
No, that was a passageway at one time.
Oh, so it was a door?
But now it's closed up. It was a door.
Stories of ghosts walking through walls that used to be an existing door sounds more like a residual type haunt. A residual haunting is like a tape player playing itself over and over again. For whatever reason, it appears that the energy from the traumatic experience is trapped in an object in the surrounding area.
So where to now?
So we're going to the second deck. In this area, the torpedo hit the rudder and the one propeller fell off. And there were men injured near death and they couldn't get out. Most naturally, it was war. It was a terrible thing.
I was working the graveyard shift, and I could hear thunder and lightning. And the lightning and the thunder was really brilliant that night. All the power went out on the ship. Right about that time, I started hearing men screaming. Voices, loud voices. Amongst the bright light from the lightning, I immediately saw numerous bodies. And they were just running back and forth across the ship. I would see the bodies flashing across.
Really want to say thank you very much for the tour.
Can't wait to get started.
Yeah, pretty much. This guy now has the trouble of trying to get all the cameras up and going in all these areas. All right, well, come on, let's get out of here.
After you, please.
Whenever you're setting up an investigation this big, we could run into problems with the cords, trying to run the cords to all the cameras, trying to wire the ship, and it'll eat up a lot of our investigation time.
I'm going to get the chance to investigate with Brian tonight, and I'm really looking forward to it. He's more excited and he's just so intense with it. Investigating with him is gonna give me the chance to kind of keep an eye on him and make sure he's in the right place where he needs to be in the group.
I'm an ex-Air Force man. Coming into a naval vessel is pretty good for me, pretty patriotic. You know, it brings back a lot of memories of myself in the Air Force days. Hopefully we can go down into the different decks and different levels and find some ghosts for the crew that work in here still.
I think the main challenges we're going to be up against is definitely the size of the ship, the amount of cord we need to run, and power issues. And it's a big metal container, and we need to really worry about sound issues.
If you look in camera one, that's the area where they heard some voices, etc. That's in the engine room. Camera two is the catwalk where the mist formed. It turned into a person that was see-through. Camera angle three is one of the corridors where they've heard some different voices and seen some things. Camera four is where they've seen a male apparition disappear into the side of the wall.
Good job. All right, guys, well, let's get this going. Let's get lights out.
This is awesome. I love battleships, aircraft carriers.
This is the best part of investigating, man.
Yeah.
Breaking the stuff.